Take your Bibles and turn with me once again to the book of Philippians. Philippians chapter 2. This morning we're going to continue the series we started last week on joy from the jailhouse. Last week we learned how to make the best of a bad situation. The Apostle Paul was writing from prison. He was encouraging the church at Philippi to understand that the things that were going on in his life, that God was certainly aware of those things. That he was in control even though Paul was in prison, and that God was going to use his imprisonment to further the gospel. Well, this morning we want to continue thinking about the book of Philippians. Paul turns to chapter 2 and he gives us some really interesting instructions. In fact, it's many of us would probably say it's pretty hard for us to follow the instructions that he gives. And the instruction is basically that as a Christian, our obligation is to put others first. Now, I don't know about you, but I titled this message, it's not hard to find good examples, it's hard to follow good examples. Because that putting other people first is countercultural. How many of you know that? It goes completely against everything that our world teaches us. Education says that we need to be smart, and so we need to put ourselves first, and we need to grow in that direction. The realist says we need to be strong, and so we look out for self. The materialist says we need to be possessive, and so we need to get all that we can, please ourselves. Pride says we need to be superior, and so we have to promote ourselves. Religion says we need to be good, so we have to behave ourselves. It's all about us. Jesus says we must humble ourselves and become servants of others. It's really interesting what Philippians teaches us, especially in the second chapter, because there is not a lack of good examples. In fact, Paul's going to give us four examples that have to take place, four people that we can imitate. You know, we're all imitators. A mammoth cave in Kentucky is one of the largest cave systems in the world today. You can get in the middle of that thing, and if you yelled out, it's kind of like this room this morning. It kind of echoes. You can hear that same sound reverberating. All of us are like an echo. We imitate, we sound back the things that we hear, the values that others experience that are around us, the character that other people have. Here's the question. Are we following good examples in order to echo those lives? Paul begins and he gives us some really harsh words. He gives us an almost impossible looking task to put others first. Philippians chapter 2 verse 1. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up when you found it. Listen to what Paul says. Therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if there's any comfort of fellowship, of love, any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Listen to what he says. Listen to this. This is important. Let nothing, how much?
Nothing.
How much?
Nothing.
Let nothing be done through selfish ambition. Boy, that's countercultural. That goes against everything the world stands for. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. What a challenge. Paul says that the Christian life is about me somehow learning to put you first, to put your needs before mine, to put your desires before mine, to somehow sacrifice myself, my wishes, my wants, my desires for you. See, he said, let nothing be done through selfish ambition. Let nothing be done out of conceit. But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Where do we see examples of that in our world today? Where do we see examples in the church today? Can you imagine the difference it would make in the church? And Paul is writing to bring unity in the body of Christ. Can you imagine the difference it would make in our homes? Can you imagine the difference it would make in our world if you and I, as believers, if everyone who claims to be a follower of Jesus Christ, if we would just come to the place in our life where we decided we were going to sacrifice self and put other people's needs ahead of our own? Can you imagine the impact that it would have if we were willing to say, it's not about me, it's about Him? Well, good examples are not hard to find. They are in our world, but fortunately for us, Paul gives us some examples. He gives us great examples that we can follow. I've got to be honest with you. They're not hard to find. They are hard to follow. Good examples are always difficult to imitate. Anyone can echo what they hear the preacher say. Anyone can echo what the world is declaring. But it's a challenge to put others first. Look at your neighbor and tell them, buckle up for the challenge. Tell them right now. Let's continue reading this second chapter. We're going to finish the chapter, come back, and I'm going to show you what Paul is teaching us here. Listen to what he says, verse 5. Look for those things that have to take place in my life and in your life, the changes that must come about if we're going to do what he says. Let's start all over verse 1. Therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if there's any comfort of love, if there's any fellowship of the Spirit, if there's any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. He gives us the first example, Jesus. Great example to follow. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even to death, to the death of the cross. He put you and me before himself, even to the place of death. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those in heaven and on the earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, as you've always obeyed, not as much in my presence only, but now also in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Bring it to completion is what he's saying. For it is God who works in you. He will empower you to both to will and to do His good pleasure. Do all things. How many things?
All.
Listen to it. Without complaining. Oh my goodness. Some of us would never say a word if we could not complain. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Here's what he says. We're supposed to be different. If you're complaining about the government the way the world is, you're not being different. And please, there's a lot to complain about there. We've got to finish the chapter. I'm going to cut loose to preach before I get done with the chapter. Let's keep reading. Verse 15, that you may be blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Hold fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ that I have not run in vain or labored in vain. Yes, and if I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I'm glad and I rejoice with all of you. For this same reason, you also be glad and rejoice with me. Well, you know, looking at Jesus and Paul, we can say, oh, well, they're great examples, but I could never be like them. But then he gives us two examples of people that you and I can be like. Timothy's the first one. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly, that I may also be encouraged when I know of your state. For I have no one like-minded who would sincerely care for your state. For all seek their own. Not the things which are of Christ, but you know His proven character, that as a son with his father, he served me in the gospel. Therefore, I hope to send him at once, as soon as I see how it goes with me. But I trust in the Lord that I myself shall also come shortly. Yet I considered it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother, my fellow worker, my fellow soldier, but your messenger and the one who ministered to my needs, since he was longing for you all and was distressed that you had heard that he was sick. For indeed he was sick, almost to death. But God had mercy on him, and not only on him, but upon me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore I send him more eagerly, that when you see him again, you may rejoice, and that I may be less sorrowful. Receive him with gladness, therefore, in the Lord, with all gladness, and hold such men in esteem. Because of the work of Christ, he came close to death. Not regarding his life, he supplied what was lacking in your service toward me. Here are examples, great examples of people who have decided to put others first. God wants me to come to the place in my spiritual life and development where I am willing to put you first. Repeat this after me. God wants me to put you first. I got to tell you, this is hard. It's hard for us to take the focus off of ourselves and to put it on the needs of others. It's hard for us to be those kinds of people that will actually focus on the needs of those around us instead of being centered on ourselves. And yet God wants us to put others first. Good examples are there. He's given us at least four opportunities to see those examples. In Christ, in Timothy, in Epaphroditus, and in God Himself. As He puts us, our needs, above those of His own. Think with me for just a minute about the changes that have to take place. Following the right example requires, number one, it requires a change in my thinking. He begins by saying, let this mind be in you that was also in Christ. You see, what I struggle with is I want to claim my own rights. I want to believe that somehow, some way, that I have some kind of authority or some kind of rights, or I ought to be able to defend myself. And yet we see the example of Christ, how that He was the authority, equal with God, and yet He humbled Himself. He thought more about you and me than He did about Himself. He was willing to die on the cross, not looking after His own care, but looking after our needs and our care. He is our example of how we should have a change in our thinking and in our thought processes. Listen to what it says. Let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made Himself of no reputation. Taking the form of a bondservant, coming in the likeness of men, being found in the appearance as a man, He humbled Himself and became obedient to the point of death, even to death on the cross. Here's the mind of Christ. Humble yourself. See, the problem we face is, I don't know about you, I'm prideful. I don't like it when people say I'm wrong. How about you? I don't like it when I determine in my own heart that I'm wrong. I would rather stand on my own two feet than to look for help. And yet we read in this passage that the mind of Christ was one of humility. Being willing to step aside from that issue of pride. How different the world would be if I put the mind of Christ at work in my life. If I saw Him making sacrifices and I followed Him in making sacrifices for others. Let's be honest. We don't sacrifice very much today. The amount that Christians give to reach other people is minuscule. When it comes to giving to charity, guess what? Non-Christians give just as much percentage-wise as those who claim to be followers of Christ. Statistically, we all talk about tithing our 10%. Let me tell you. Not happening. And this is not about preaching sermons about tithing either. This is about being willing to sacrifice for the needs of others. We're always more focused on our own needs than we are the needs of those around us. So I've got to change my way of thinking. Before I can put you ahead of my own desires, I must develop the mind of Christ. I've got to be willing to do what Christ did, and that is to descend into greatness. He was equal with God. That's pretty authoritative. That's more authority than you and I would ever experience. But He became as a human being, became as a man, became as a servant, and died on the cross for our sins. He descended, and then this is what the Father said. Paul said, and then God exalted Him and raised Him up. You see, it's only as we surrender ourselves to God and begin to think more like Jesus, it's only as we begin to submit ourselves and to take that downward step of servitude, serving one another, only then can the Father work in our life to elevate us. Only then can He bring us to that place where we find satisfaction and peace. It's a great example to follow, not easy to follow. It's hard to be like Jesus. Before I can put you first, I'm going to have to develop the mind of Christ. Second thing we discover. Following the right example requires not only changing my way of thinking, but changing my allegiance. I have to change my allegiance. Notice what it says. Therefore, God has highly exalted Him and given Him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee would bow, every tongue confess in heaven and those on the earth, that every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That word Lord is an interesting word. It means boss. It means boss. You see, what we have to do, what I'm going to have to do before I can put you first, is I'm going to have to change my allegiance and let Jesus be the boss of my life. Heavenly Father says that's what's coming. One day every knee, every person will claim Jesus as Lord. If I'm going to put you first, I'm going to have to start claiming Him as Lord today. That's countercultural because this is what we want to do. We want to be our own authority. We want to be our own boss. Wikipedia. Anybody familiar with Wikipedia? Wikipedia is the online encyclopedia. And the way that works is it's called open source. Everybody that's got any idea about any subject on the face of the earth can just pool their ideas about that subject, and that becomes the definition and it just defines what that subject is all about. Well, that's given rise to a new expression. You ought to look this one up. Yahwism. It's a new religious movement. And it's based on the same principle of open source. And everybody just comes with whatever they're thinking and they just kind of combine it all together and they come out with their own authority. There is no God. All of us are divine. There is no God for us to be accountable to. Truth is whatever you and I together come together and determine it to be. Yahwism. You see, before I can ever serve you, before I can ever put you first, I must first examine my own life and let Jesus be the boss. I can't live my life a Wikipedia style. I can't live my life worshiping with Yahwism. I can't be determining what's right and what's wrong in my own. I'm going to have to let Him determine what's right and wrong. He has to become the final arbitrator of truth for my life. This is what God said. One day, every knee, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord of all. He's going to be the boss. If I'm going to love you, I've got to follow that example. If I'm going to put you first, I'm going to have to follow His example and let Him be Lord. You know what that means? That means He has the right to interrupt my life. That means He has the right to bring my life to an end. That means that He has the right to change my plans. You see, making Him boss means that I need to be submitted to Him. He has the right to lift me up. He also has the right to take me down. See, the example is there. Easy to find, hard to follow. Look at your neighbor and say, easy to find, hard to follow. See, if I'm going to do what Paul says, let nothing be done through selfish ambition and conceit, then I'm going to have to change my way of thinking. I'm going to have to change my allegiance. Third thing, it'll require a change in my attitude. Now I'm going to meddling. Notice what Paul says, verse 14 and 16. Do all things without complaining and disputing. Oh, it's too hot in here today. that light right there just kind of shines in my eyes. It's too bright. There was snow on the ground again this morning. Somebody came in this morning. I think it was Jim Ketchum came in and said, I got up this morning. I couldn't remember what day it was. Looked out and saw the snow on the ground. I said, it must be Sunday because that's the way it's been going. Isn't it interesting, the things that we want to complain about? The preacher goes too long. The preacher doesn't go long enough. This is happening. That's happening. The other thing is happening. He said, don't complain about anything. I got to tell you, great example. Hard to follow. Easy to find. Hard to follow. Don't complain about anything. He says, be different. We have to have an attitude that sets us apart from the world. Listen to what he says. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless, children of God without fault. Listen, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run or labored in vain. Oh, my goodness. Now, do you think it would be possible that more people would consider taking the claims of Christ seriously, that they would consider becoming a Christian, if you and I as Christians weren't too busy living like them? If there was a difference in the way that we live, if we weren't the ones leading the charge when it comes to complaining, if we weren't the ones that were always belly aching about everything, getting our feelings hurt over nothing, if we were the ones that were living a different life and actually shining like lights in a darkened world, don't you think some people might be more attracted to Christ? But here's the problem. They look at us and they see themselves already. Paul said, if I'm going to put you first, then I'm going to have a change not only of my thinking, not only of my allegiance, but of my attitude. Let me tell you what the future looks like for God's people. It looks good. I don't know what tomorrow holds, but I know this. When everything is said and done, I'm on the winning side. It's only going to get better for me. I don't know about you. Only you can determine that about you. I've read the end of the book. I know who wins in the end. And I know what awaits me out there. I know what lies before me, but it takes a change in my attitude. Before I can care for you, I've got to change my attitude toward you. How many times do we complain about other people for nothing? Do all without complaining and disputing. Wow. Do all? I don't know about you. I got some work to do. The example is easy to find, hard to follow. Easy to find, hard to follow. Fourth thing to discover. It's going to require a change in my character. Following the right example requires a change in my character. He goes to Timothy. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly, that I may be encouraged when I know of your state. For I have no one like-minded who will sincerely care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are of Christ, except Timothy. That's the implication there. But you know his, here it is, proven character. Let me tell you something. Reputation is what people see when you're there. Your character is what goes with you when you leave. Character is the way you behave when you're not around everybody else. Character is what you do on Monday, not what you do on Sunday. See, we've all got our Sunday go-to-meeting characters on today. Growing up in Tennessee, it was always your Sunday go-to-meeting clothes. Well, the clothes don't make the man. It's the character that makes the man. Our reputation is what you think of me when we're together. My character is the way that I live my life when we're apart. Character is how I respond in the darkness when nobody sees what's going on. Paul says, before I can really care for you, before I can sacrifice for you, before I can put you first, it's going to require a change in my character. God is going to have to do a work inside me so that my character can be proven like Timothy's character was proven. You see, here's the thing. Before I can care for you, I have to realize how much He cares for you. That's a character issue. Because see, what I believe is that he cares a lot more about me than he does anybody else. Isn't that the way you think? That he's more interested in me than he is you. It's going to take a change of character. I'm going to have to be focused on how he feels about you. Easy to find, hard to follow. Repeat it after me. Easy to find, hard to follow. Man, Jesus, easy to find, great example. Nobody in this room would disagree with that. Great example, hard to follow. God, whoo, great example, declaring Jesus is Lord, got to be the boss. Easy to find, hard to follow. Timothy, man of character, easy to find. Genuinely cared, hard to follow. Hard to follow. Changing our attitudes, changing our thinking, changing our allegiances, changing our character. Last one, number five. It requires a change in my priorities. Epaphroditus, big name, nobody knows who he is. We forget about him. He appears a couple of times in Scripture. But for some reason, Paul talks about him. And he points out the priority of his life. You know what it was? It was to serve Christ. It was to serve the gospel. That was the number one thing that he wanted to do, was to serve Christ. Listen to what it says about him. Yet I considered it necessary to ascend to Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, my fellow soldier, but your messenger and the one who ministered to my needs. Receive him, therefore, in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such men in esteem, because for the work of Christ, he was willing to sacrifice and to come close to death. He didn't regard his own life, and he was even willing to supply materially what was lacking in your service toward me. His priority was different. It is amazing to me, our priorities. You know how easy it is to come up with an excuse not to go to church on Sunday? I was surprised we got this many people this morning. You know what? It snowed last night. Now, let's be honest. Sometimes when it snows, that's a good excuse. It's cold and that bed is just so warm and I can roll over and cover up a little bit more and kind of hunker. I can worship God right here at Bed Springs Baptist Church. Yeah. Isn't it amazing? The priorities of our life. The example that God gives us is a great example. He says that this is what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to put the needs of others first. Let me tell you something about going to church. When you're not here, you're cheating everybody else out of your gifts and abilities, out of the blessing of your life. That's why going to church is so important. Beyond what you may actually get out of it, you are cheating other people out of what you contribute to it. Epaphroditus. Paul said this about him. He said, this guy was willing to put Christ first in his life. He wasn't worried about his health. He wasn't worried about his wealth. He wasn't worried about his own welfare. He cared so much about your ministry to me, his ministry to you, that he came and lay it all on the line, putting Christ first. You see, the reality is, I will never, ever care for you until I put Jesus Christ first in my life. I can give a lot of lip service to it. I can stand up here on Sunday morning and talk about it and preach sermons on it. I can go through the motions on Sunday morning. But again, that's my reputation, not necessarily my character. My character is what do I do on Monday toward you? How do I follow through? My character dictates where my priorities are. Am I putting Christ first? Have I put Him first in my life? Listen, easy to find, hard to follow. What are your priorities in life? Building up a nest egg for retirement? Getting more toys to play with? What are the priorities that we set? Paul gives us Epaphroditus as a great example of one who is willing to put the needs of others before his own. Wow. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit. In lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each one of you look not only to his own interest, but also the interest of others. What a challenge to start looking at other people differently. For me to do that, it's going to take everything Paul points out to us. It's going to take a change in my way of thinking. It's going to take a change of allegiance. Jesus has to be my boss. It's going to take a change of attitude. I'm going to have to be different than the rest of the world. It's going to have to take a change in my character. It's going to mean I'm going to have to change my priorities. That Jesus must be first. Here's the order of things. Him first, you second. Because I will never put you in your right place until I first put him in his right place. Now, some of you are sitting there going, but what about me? See, that's where we live. Well, if all of us decide to put the other person first, then I don't have to worry if I put you first. Because I'm going to have 600 other people putting me first. And if I put him first and lift him up and exalt him by the way that I live, if I'm willing to descend, my Heavenly Father is more than willing to elevate, to raise us up. Okay, so how do we begin this process? This process of change, how does it come about? Three things have to happen. It's always the same three. First, you must accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord. See, the reality is, before I can put you first, He has to become first to me. The first step is to accept Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me. I've got to put Him first. I've got to accept Him as my personal Savior and Lord. I've got to surrender my life to Him and let Him be boss. Second thing, I have to commit myself to follow Him. Oh, see, here's where the rubber hits the road. The example that He gives, easy to find. Just look in the Bible. Hard to follow. Just look in the Bible. Loving your enemies. Forgiving those that abuse you. Easy to find. Hard to follow. We must commit ourselves to follow Him. And lastly, trust Him to transform you. We have to trust Him to change us. To change our attitudes, our actions. To change us from the inside out. To change our character from who we are to who we need to be. We need to be men and women who are willing to be that light that's different than the rest of the world, because we have come to the place where we put Christ first and others after Him. Accept Him, commit to Him, and trust Him. And He will change your life, our church, and I believe our world.